Again, welcome everyone, and thank you for joining today's Executive Leadership Series webinar hosted by the Digital Academy here at Ohio University's Voinovich School of Leadership and Public Affairs. My name is Dr. Alexander Murray, and again, I'm your webinar moderator for today. Our guest speaker for this webinar series is Beverly Jones, who will be leading a discussion on mindset, confidence, and building your leadership brand. Beverly is a Voinovich School Professional Fellow and consultant for both corporate and institutional leaders, helping them to bring productivity to organizations at all levels. She also coaches executives and professionals to address strategic challenges, navigate through transitions, and create more productive work lives. Beverly has a broad client base that includes the Federal Reserve, the U.S. Department of Agriculture, universities, media executives, and wealth managers, just to name a few. Beverly is also the author of the 2015 Career Press bestseller, Think Like an Entrepreneur, Act Like a CEO, 50 Indispensable Tips to Help You Stay Afloat, Bounce Back, and Get Ahead at Work. It's a really good book, so if you haven't picked it up yet or read it, I really do suggest that you do that. She is also the host of the Jazzed About Work podcast that is nationally distributed by NPR. So at this time, without further ado, I'm going to turn the discussion over to Beverly Jones.
Thanks, Alex. That was a long and wonderful introduction. And thank you all for being here. I'm excited about doing the first and what I think will perhaps be a series of webinars exploring some of my favorite issues related to building a rewarding and resilient career. Today, we're going to talk about branding and what it means for your leadership growth and why your attitudes and confidence level can impact your growth and your brand. Now, I always start out by trying to talk about branding as something that is not creepy. I know a lot of people kind of cringe at the idea of personal branding because it, for some people, it has a feeling of being something fake. And that's not it at all. It's actually the opposite. When we're talking about your brand, we're talking about the image of you, hopefully really grounded in the truth, but the image of you which distinguishes you from everybody else, from all your colleagues, your competitors. It's the thing that people see in their head when they start thinking about you. And hopefully your brand is reflective of your core values, but it's also shaped by what you project. Nobody's going to know about your core values or your good work if you don't share them. So the way you actively manage your brand becomes important. Another point about branding I want to mention is that it is not just what you do or say or the long list of your accomplishments. A big part of your brand is how you make other people feel. And you can think about that in the context of a product brand that you really like. Say, if you're a Starbucks fan, it maybe you don't even like their coffee. But what you like is when you're traveling and you see that green sign, you can go into the Starbucks and you know it'll be friendly and they'll take your order in a cheerful way. And you can sit there and they won't chase you out, and you'll kind of feel comfortable at home, even though you're in a different town. That way Starbucks makes you feel is something they've created consciously. Their brand is about comfort and community and things like that. And you have a brand in the same way. Think about maybe a teacher or a boss that you really liked at some point, and it didn't necessarily mean that they said something brilliant every time you were with them, but you spent a little time with them, you felt better. Their brand was partly making you feel good about yourself. So that's an important aspect of your brand. And for professionals, it is never too early to think about how you show up as a leader, how you're projecting as part of your brand the potential and the actual achievement of being a leader. And I say it's never too early. I think that that's absolutely the case. It is something that leadership starts at the very beginning of maybe, you know, when you're in school. Don't you know that you can think about people who, when you were kids and you were playing baseball or whatever it was, you knew they were going to be leaders? Leaders, people who grow into leaders, tend to be easy to spot early on. One of the things they do is they spot problems. I've noticed, you know, I've worked with interns and young professionals for many years, and I think of some of them who grew to be really super successful in their fields. And as I think about it, we kind of knew, the people around them knew early on. And one of the reasons is they took responsibility when there was a problem. Maybe as interns, they were very low in the hierarchy, but somebody spilled a cup of coffee, they were up to get the mop. Somebody needed something, they were trying to help. Even if the problem was bigger than they could address, they were looking for a way to add value. So if you're in a business situation, if you're at a job and you feel like you're not getting a lot of traction and you want to tweak your brand a bit, a good thing is to start looking around and seeing, watching for when people have a problem, could use some help in some way. Looking for an opportunity to give a little bit of help is how you show up as a leader, and it's how you start to weave leadership into your brand. And another thing about leadership is that you are acting like a leader when you treat other people with respect and you're positive in your interactions with them. And even when you're having a bad day, you're not whining and complaining, but instead you're being in the range of neutral to positive. And whenever possible, you're leaving people with maybe feeling a little bit more positive themselves. And you can create a positive vibe, kind of a positive leadership vibe, simply by looking at people's face, look them straight in the eye. Smiling can help, but really listening is a huge way to help other people feel positive. So finally, anytime you accept responsibility for your work, no matter how trivial or boring or inconsequential you may feel it is, if you accept the responsibility and you follow through and you do it, if you show up and you do the work, then you're acting like a leader. So how do you start feeling like a leader? How do you know you're going to be when you're a leader? And how could you be more like a leader? I've found working with clients that an almost magical thing starts happening if you can identify some characteristics of leadership that you admire. A good thing, good exercise to do is sit down, make a list of maybe, I don't know, 3 to 5 leaders who you've really liked, who've influenced you. And it can be anybody from President Obama to your homeroom teacher, people who served a leadership role in your life. And then make another list of characteristics that those people tend to exhibit. It may be that some of the characteristics show up for everyone, but make a list. Perhaps they're positive, perhaps they're supportive, perhaps they're great listeners, but make a list of the things that stand out in your mind. And right there, you will have articulated a good start to your own sense of what leadership is. Next thing to do might be to go to the research. And what is leadership is something that endless PhD candidates and highly accomplished academics have studied for years and years and years. What they've tried to do is figure out what are the characteristics that we look for when we're selecting potential leaders, when we're hiring people, when we're trying to decide who to encourage? On the slide there, you'll see eight characteristics that show up in the research. Some of these might have been on your list, but people who are well-organized and collaborative and positive, these kinds of things are very, very common. And so even if they didn't show up in your original list, you might look at these eight things and decide, is this something that resonates with you? From there, and kind of taking these words into account, imagine that your boss and a colleague, or maybe your best friends, or maybe somebody who is recruiting you for a job. Imagine these folks are sitting around and they're talking about you. They're describing you in a professional context, perhaps. So think about this conversation. Now imagine, what do you want to have them saying about you? Are they using these words? Are there some more specific things like, we always can count on this person, or I just start to rely on the enthusiasm? Think about those kind of things. So now you've got a collection of words and maybe words and phrases. It's maybe a long list, but it never hurts to kind of narrow down a list like this. I think about 5 to 7 characteristics is maybe a good number of things that you want to have in your head. So why don't you boil it down to that list? And now you have your list of what your vision of leadership is. And the next step is simple and complicated. Basically, you start acting like that. You start acting in that way. So if you have a challenge and you don't know what to do, you think about a leader with those characteristics and you ask yourself, what would that person do? A game I played with myself is invented a much better version of myself, who I call in my head Uber Bev. And Uber Bev kind of lives up to the characteristics I aspire to. And when I don't know what to do, or when I'm feeling challenged or tempted or whatever, I kind of ask myself, what would Uber Bev do? And she's much smarter and more consistent than I am. And that gives me a guide. And once you start building on your leadership, the next thing you want to do is appearing confident as a leader. Now, I'll tell you, if you look at these 7 characteristics every day, it's going to change the way you come across because, frankly, if you have these thoughts in mind, it shows in the way you move, the way you speak, the way you carry yourself. But there are more things that you can do to be confident and to come across as a confident leader. On the slide, there's a phrase, growth mindset, which is a whole huge thing. And we only have a limited amount of time, but I wanted to be sure to mention what that means and how it can impact the growth of your confidence. Growth mindset is a term that psychologist Carol Dweck, I think, was the first one who coined that term. Psychologists have been using for maybe 30 years. A mindset, in their terms, is an attitude and also a belief system. It's how you think about something, your sort of firm view of something. A growth mindset is a mindset in which you believe that you are capable of learning and growing and becoming more intelligent. In recent years, neuroscience has found that we can become smarter and more compassionate, and we can grow in the direction of the characteristics we want to have. And we do that by believing that we can grow. It seems like your brain, if you think you can't grow, your brain will somehow hear that and won't let you. But the science shows that if you believe you can grow and you work on it, your brain will work with you. So the first thing you want to do if you're not feeling confident is start saying to yourself something like, I know I can be like this leader. I know I can do this work. Maybe this didn't work out last week, but I'll figure it out and I'll do it next week. Working on recognizing that the reality that we now know, which is that you can grow and get better and learn to do things, that's a really, really important thing. Another thing you can do to become more confident is to practice taking little risks and learn that you can overcome them. If you're shy about speaking with people, for example, just practice in some way that's very low in consequences. You can talk to your barista. You can talk to a sales clerk. Just practice speaking up a little bit. Practice speaking in a meeting. Do something that makes you a little bit afraid. Do it anyway and start moving out of your comfort zone. And the more you learn to do that in small ways, the more you're going to feel confidence and it will show. And a critical thing is to stop talking about any of the projects that don't work out or the bad days as failures. Very few things are actually failures in your professional life. Even if you start a business and it crashes or you get fired, look at the whole big picture. Your career is long and complicated and varied, and almost every misstep along the way is a critical learning experience. It's part of the whole process of building your career. So don't let yourself talk about your failures, because you'll start to believe them, and chances are they're really just learning experiences. So again, when you're afraid, you know, remember those characteristics. Maybe bravery is one of them. Act like you wish you were, and you'll find that you'll become that way. And if you start kind of naysaying, you tell your voice in your head to let it go.
Hey, Bev.
Yeah.
I want to pause there for just a second and you know, give our participants an opportunity to kind of chime in the chat window and ask any questions if they may have. But I also have a question that I want to add to that. You know, and if you can go back to that last slide. When you get into areas and we talk about, success and, talking to that inner voice, you know, I've often run into people in my career and in my life who have, you know, so-called failed in previous positions and in previous careers. And how do you influence that individual, or what could you tell that individual to kind of get over that hump? Maybe they were in an environment, or maybe they were in a work environment to where leadership or moving or climbing up that management ladder per se wasn't encouraged from their end, you know, or maybe it was an environment that was somewhat toxic and, you know, kind of suppressed their, you know, want to, you know, be confident or for growth.
Yeah.
From that standpoint, how do you guide someone from that end?
Okay, that's a very good question. Well, the first thing you have to do sometimes is clean up any mess. If you're, failure, unquote, if you cause somebody else discomfort or inconvenience or whatever, the first thing you do is you genuinely apologize and you make a promise to do better or whatever it takes. So don't belabor it, but apologize, and then the thing is to quickly move on. The way to do that that seems to work really well, and there's a good bit of research around this, is that you stop talking about the failure and you look at the whole process. What that means is, say you are trying to launch a product and you have a soft launch and it just flops. Then what you do is you kind of spread out what you're going to do if you're still working on the process. You take another look at the market. You look at what you did last time. You figure out how to tweak it, how to make it better. You come up with additional ideas. You spread it all out. And it turns out that as soon as people or a group are focusing on the process, and this is treated as just one event in a much broader scale, the pain of the failure tends to go away. The problem when you have had a really bad experience, it's like somebody kicked you in the stomach. I mean, failure really hurts. And it's easy to get hung up on it and go on this endless loop. And so what you want to do if you're coaching somebody is you want to get them to focus on the future. Maybe not the distant future, but the immediate future. And the way to that is to look at all the steps in this particular spectrum. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Are there any other questions at this point? All right, so I'm going to jump into some easy things that you can do to tweak your brand. The kind of things that I've been talking about up to now, working on your leadership presence and your executive presence and your confidence, those things can have some pretty fast impact if you work on them, if you have a vision of what you want to be. But even though the initial impact can start soon, these are also kind of lifetime endeavors, and it can take quite a while for it to play out. But what do you want to do if you think, gosh, I'd like to tweak my brand before next week? Well, first, I think it always starts to have a goal, to have a sense of what you want to be like, your version of Uber Bev. When I work on, you know, where I want to go, I invariably start working on fitness because Uber Bev in my head is so much thinner and fitter than I normally am, that it just sort of automatically triggers something. What your version will vary, but it's a good thing to do to like make lists or maybe work in a journal just so you have an idea. But even if you don't have time to do that, one thing you can do is look at some basics, and that includes your grooming and your speech habits and your punctuality. By grooming, which is kind of an old-fashioned word and people think it's old-fashioned, it's not. Grooming is how you fit into a herd, and the trick there is to kind of notice, look around, see what the leaders and the successful people are wearing. It may not be much different than yours. It may be very similar, but look around and see if there's some habits in the way you present yourself. You want to pick up with them, and you can do that by next week. Speech habits are harder to work on. A big part is negativity. Another thing is saying the same word over and over again that can drive people crazy and sound like you're a teenager. One thing you can do with a buddy is you can record each other and then give each other feedback. And in products, product managers always try to get consumer feedback. And getting feedback on your own habits or appearance, if you've got somebody you can trust, that's a good thing to do. And punctuality is a really simple one. If you tend to show up on time with energy and enthusiasm, hopefully, you signal that you're serious about the event and you signal respect. And, you know, I'm telling you not just from my observations, which I believe are true, but again, everything along these lines has been studied. And punctuality is one of the things that seems to signal your attitude about a workplace, about a person. So even if you don't mind being kept waiting and you don't think being late is a big thing, if you're trying to reshape your brand a bit and you want to make it more positive, punctuality is something to work on. I mentioned earlier that as a leader, one way you can start your image as a leader very early is to make eye contact and listen to people. And one way to get better at listening is to notice the voice in your head. And when I went to law school, they taught us to be always analytical. When somebody else was making their case, in our brains, we should be thinking about what case we were going to make. So we never really listened carefully. And I had to unlearn that as a coach and as a person. The way you get to be a better listener is notice the voice in your head, notice your own attention. And if it's wandering, bring it back and keep focusing on the other person. It's always good to offer praise if it's authentic, if it's real. And don't forget to thank people. It really feels good. Another great strategy for tweaking your brand is build expertise. Find your niche. Find something that's needed. Maybe it's a new technology nobody has the grasp of. And to come across as an expert, you just have to be better than everybody else around you so you can work up an expertise surprisingly quickly sometimes. Once you've got it, you don't brag about it. What you try to do is use it. You try to share it. One of the reasons lawyers often do really well and become highly influential in corporate environments, say, is because they have an expertise that nobody else has. And it's the same with IT people sometimes. They have an expertise. If you've got something that sets you apart and it's something people need, that strengthens your brand. Also, and look around and look at your colleagues. Look at people who are successful. And ask your friends, how can you be more like them? So all of those things can help you get your brand tweaked. And I think it's, again, something that you can keep working on. I'm still working on mine. I'm changing it. But one thing I want to mention is that part of tweaking your brand is to promote your work. And that can mean writing articles. It means sharing things with people. But this day and age requires some savvy about your online presence. The simple starting point, if you don't have one, is to work on a profile with LinkedIn. And the fact is that everybody has an online presence. Even if you think you don't, your absence says something about you. It says you're not engaged. And then finally, notice your successes and be grateful for them. If you count three things a day that went well, you'll feel better about yourself, and that will change the way you bring yourself across, and it'll change your brand. Are there any other questions?
If there's any further questions, if anyone had asked anything specific, please feel free to use the lower chat window on the right-hand panel.
Okay, well, can I make a commercial?
Absolutely.
I just wanted to mention, it's not really a commercial, but the Jazzed About Work podcast that we're doing at WOUB. Just Google NPR, Jazzed About Work, or WOUB, Jazzed About Work. If you're interested in these issues, we talk with people who really love their work, but we also talk with some of the leading career and jobs experts in the country, and we get lots of information from them. So if you're looking for more about some of these issues, that's a good free source, and we try to make it as fun and interesting as we can.